I am Anthony Sam Peezy Avery, producer, engineer, musician, all around cool guy. I am originally from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. DCH baby, we say, born and raised, been there most of my life. My parents named Michael and Willa Dean Avery. Michael's from Colin, Alabama, a little bit of town right outside Tuscaloosa. Most people now don't know is where Mercedes is. My mom is Willa Dean Avery. She's from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. My dad is energetic. Like we like to say, he on 12 all the time. But he's older now, so he's not on 12 as much. But he's very energetic. He was one of the ones that pushed me into this. And my mom is just my mom. She's sweet. That's Willa Dean, you know what I'm saying? But she says a lot without saying much, you know? And you just, if you know, you know. You don't cross Willa Dean, you know? So they kind of are the perfect dichotomy to balance to each other, you know what I'm saying? All my hustle came from my dad. Tuscaloosa, there were no band programs until you got to seventh grade. So in sixth grade, I started getting interested in it, and my dad bought me a trumpet. So when I got to seventh grade, Miss Virginia Bruce Cox asked, you know, what instrument do you want to play? And I was like, I want to play the drum. So she said, you have to be good at math, and you have to be athletic. I was like, okay, I got the math part. Well, he can't play the drums, he's athletic. So I was like, well, I got this trumpet already. Mr. Watts was my band director at Central High School, where I went in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. He drove us, and he just had this unique way of letting you know, you can do this, you know what I'm saying? And you gotta believe in you. So music as a career is still kind of a mystery, especially if you're from where I'm from Tuscaloosa. You got one or two options. You go to college, you go become a teacher or something, something. Or you go over there and work at the Impwr, Pfeiffer Wire. That's what you do if you're from Tuscaloosa. Nobody's no musician. That doesn't happen. I'm a rebel, unfortunately. Me and college didn't get along. The first semester I was there, I flunked out. Well, you get put on probation first, and then the next semester was like, oh, he's suspended. Don't, you know, I think my GPA was a point something. And, you know, I don't know. I had more W's than F's. And just, it was crazy, man, but I love music. I just love music. So at that point, I was playing at my church, playing drums at church. And it wasn't until like that year after we flunked out, my best friend, Roderick Prince, came to me and said, "Aunt, I got the hustle, dog. I got it. We're going to make beats for rappers." Money and making no beats for rappers, number one. Number two, there aren't enough rappers to make beats. I can say this now and it's hilarious, but this is 1994, so it's like there's no future in this, man. You know, I'm already screwed up, I flunked out of school, I gotta figure this out, and now you telling me we're gonna go make beats for rappers. He's like, yeah, I already went and got the loan from my credit union, I went and got this keyboard, he went and got a Korg X2, I'll never forget it. And he was like, it's at the house and it's got everything you need on it. And he was like, I know you can do it, man, because you can play it. And I was like, all right. So we go to the house and we just started fooling around with it. It had a record function on it and all of that, and a little sequencer and all that. And we started making our little beats. I remember my first beat was like, it was the cycle of fills to a beat. So it's like, you know, little stuff like that. Fate would have it, we're riding around on campus. Chris had went to Howard and he came home. And we were riding around the University of Alabama campus. And we heard this hip hop station. And we was like, what station is that? You know, that's not TUG. If you from Tuscaloosa, that's not TUG. That's not Win 107. They playing straight underground hip hop. Pat Latham was the DJ. And he said, he called us at WVUA 34. I can't remember the number, but he was saying, yeah, call us and come in. And Rob was like, all right. He called and he was like, you know, you're on the air. And he was like, yo, This is Rod, and I got my boy Ant, and we got some beats. So we went down there, and we got it, and we all excited. You know, we done been on no radio or nothing like that. And he was like playing, the part where they was just like talk, he put our beat tape on. And you know, and the beat tape's playing in the background. It could have been a few minutes later, Cat calls in, and he says, yo, I'm trying to meet them cats that make beats. And Pat's like, well, they up here. You need to just come on through. You know, they up here. That would later be Bonebreaker Jones. Carl Jones, my homie.
The first ever official, if you will, meeting. We were at a VUA, the radio station, WVUA 90.7. And when I was in school, I used to DJ up at the radio station. And I was up there just hanging out with one of my homeboys who did the hip-hop show, DJ Extra P.A.T. And we were sitting there talking while he was playing music, and some kind of way we got into a dare if he went live on the air that I wouldn't freestyle. And the dare turned into a reality. And I mean, this was at the time where hardly nobody used to, you know, call in or anything like that. You just had your loyal few.
Yeah.
But when I did that freestyle, as soon as we got off the air and went back, the phone just started lighting up. Everybody was like, now people want to come up there. Can I freestyle? Oh, can y'all play my music? Da 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 da. So that very next week, it went from just like being me and Pat just kicking it to like people trying to buzz in to get into the studio. And it was a good amount of people there. And two of the guys that came were, at the time, Dick Dastardly and yeah. Princeton Magnificent.
Yeah.
And but everybody, there probably had to be about 15 or so people in there. Everybody like, you know, I rap, da 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 da. And then you get to those dudes, we make beats.
Because now, again, I'm from Tuscaloosa. I'm not from New York, I'm not from L.A., so I didn't know nothing about no SP-1200s or no MPCs. All I knew was I wanted to sound like what it sound like on there. Mama dropped me a class, and she would drop me at Gordon Palmer Hall. And I'd be like, bye, Mom. And I'd just watch her walk off, and I would walk right down the hill. And I'm telling on myself, Mom, I'm sorry. But I would walk right down the hill to the Highlands where Carl and Oscar stayed. And Carl worked at Shoney's, and he was working night shift. And I would just go knock on his window. He knew what time it was, and he'd get up. And he'd do like that, and he'd just open the door. And he'd go back to bed, and I'd go in the living room. And in the living room was the setup with the keyboard, the mic, the drum machine, and a Super Nintendo. So it was like all day, it's beats, Nintendo, beats, Nintendo. Carl would get up around 2, getting ready to go back to work. Oscar be getting off of class, Mike getting out. Everybody come around 3 or 4 o'clock. Getting ready to get set off, and I would just take my headphones off and be like, there y'all go. We finally found this place called Front Row Studios in Birmingham. I think it's called Audio State 55 or something like that now. It's in Woodlawn. And John Kleiner was our engineer, and we recorded a 6-song EP called Foshnik Presents. And our first song off of that was called Who Can Rock the Party. And there was this thing on this new station called 95.7 at that point, Jams in Birmingham. And they had like your number one, number two, you vote for the song. And back then that was the first time it had happened. And DJ Corey D, I think that was his name, I can't remember his name, I know he's passed. But he was the first guy that did it. And we heard about it and we was like, well, we gonna ever find out if we worth something, send our song up there. See what happens. And the first night we send our song and we win. And the second night we win. And the third night we win. And from that point, we were like celebrities on campus. Like, for real, for real. Like, that's when church got back involved. And it was like, okay, I got to calm down again. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, I got to make a choice between I'm going to be Rem Avery or I'm going to be, you know, at that point, Dick Dastardly. You know which one you're going to be, you know. But the problem was, even though I had a calling, it was still like, I still want to do it, though. So, I'll never forget. My dad comes to me, and at that point, his health was failing. And we thinking, this might be it. Here we are in 2020, still here. But anyway, in 98, it's like, I want to do a family business. What do you and your brother want to do? I'm like, I don't know if it's going to be like Motown, but yeah, I want to run a record label. So he was like, okay. My dad took me to Mars Music in Birmingham and went to the keyboards and said, get everything you need. Get it. Go on and get it. And I got a Korg Triton. It was brand new. I got the Triton with the CD burning and the joint like 24 hours. I ain't sleep. I put it in the closet upstairs. I posted up in the closet. I still don't know why I went in the closet, but I posted up in the closet and I did all my beats and I was like, Dad, I'm ready. You know, and he booked my studio time at Bass Brothers with me and my brother. And we were going to talk about, you know, we from the South. South, you know, that was during that whole point where the South got something to say, South got something to say. So we did that and that happened. And the only reason that album never came out, and I can say this on camera now, it never came out because my dad made me make a promise that if I did that album, there would be no cursing on it. Which, to my point, I did. When I turned my brother and my cousin them loose on there, it was over. He was like, I'm cutting the fund. So he cut the funding off and I ain't had no more money. So probably never saw the light of day. You know what I'm saying? But it sparked something. And by that point, I was like, all right, I got to do this. You know what I'm saying? And I meet this tall white boy named Jim Correa. I'm doing beats over there at the same time. And Jim's just like, you want to be my partner? And I'm like, yeah. And it, you know, I can say to this day, there was never really no paperwork, no nothing. It was back then, it was just the handshake. We in business, Woodshed, you know what I'm saying? And we called it Woodshed because, like I said, the place that was behind it, that was Jim's granddad's land. So that land been in their family for a long time. And they just always referred to it as the Woodshed. And before you know it, you know, rappers from Tuscaloosa coming to the Woodshed to get beat for me. Me and Alabama Cash come to the Apache Cafe. Really just hanging out. It was not a plan. We were just hanging. And me and Cash are in there, and they're like, it's a beat battle. And I'm like, beat battle? How does this work? And they was like, well, yo, we just put people on stage and the best beat win, and the winner get to keep half of the pot from every night. The Cash pulls a rack out of his pocket and said, I got $1,000 on my man right now if y'all let him in. And I'm looking at him like, I don't know how this works, you know what I'm saying? But he's like, $1,000, you let him in right now. And Hotep was like, yo, no, chill. We're going to do this next month. But the next month was like Christmas, so we had to take it off. So I had 2 months to get ready. So in January, the following year, which I think was 06, January I come to my first beat battle. Like, I'm in it, and I'm nervous. Nervous is an understatement, because this was really the first time I'm finna display this to the world. That's how I'm looking at it. Because if you were at the Apache during them beat battles back then, it was everybody, like literally everybody. So I come there in January, and from the first beat, I had them around my fingers, you know, it was over. And I won so much that made me stop battling. But to this point, I didn't even know what a placement was, you know, because I didn't know how none of this worked. Again, I'm from Alabama. I don't know how any of this works. There was some huge placements where people demoed records, sent me the record back, talking to me on the phone like, you finna be big, this is it. And you look at the album and your record ain't on there. And that happened for me like 3-4 years. So if you're talking about, again, we talked about life. Life is still happening while I'm doing this. I got married at that point. And while this is happening, while I'm married, my ex-wife gets pregnant. And so it's like, that's my first child. And I'm like, okay, this gotta work now. You know what I'm saying? And in the midst of all of that, me trying to make all this happen and it not working, I lost my daughter. So, you know, now it's like, okay, why am I doing what I'm doing? Because there's something in me, and it's something that just wouldn't let me quit. You know what I'm saying? Because I was supposed to quit then. That was designed to make me quit. And I'm not going to get in the camera with all I got into at that point. It was bad. You know what I'm saying? But stuff is still going. I still got beats going out. I still got people hearing stuff. But I kind of don't care. You know, I'm just doing it now just to be doing it. And the business of Tuscaloosa is going haywire. You know, people are taking me into him for granted. All kinds of stuff. It just kind of goes crazy. So, finally, in 2009, partner of mine, Fabian Hook. Five, we call him Five. Fabian just comes over one day and he's like, why you here? And I was like, this is all I got. You know what I'm saying? And he was like, nah, come on. So he moves me with him to Woodstock, which, you know, is close enough to Atlanta. You know what I'm saying? I'm moving to Atlanta, you know, now that I know I'm like Woodstock, way up in Canton, man. I'm freaking Atlanta, but, you know? So I'm like, but I'm over here, you know? And that started a whole nother journey. And was like, while I was there, though, I got forced to face myself. I had to look myself in the mirror. That's the point I had to, like, I got to stop. So at that point, I'm mostly by myself. Fabian had this real nice house and this real nice studio. And I'm having to work late at night by myself. And on those nights by myself, that's, you know, when you're in there, you know, creating or whatever, and you in your own mind, that can be a dangerous place. You know, I had just lost my daughter. My marriage was over, so now I'm divorced. And I'm just there, and it was, I didn't realize I had developed a drinking problem. So Fabian's wife, God bless her, one morning we were coming to breakfast, and she just stopped, just very nonchalantly. She said, Sam? I said, yeah. She said, are you depressed? And I went, I don't think so. You know what I'm saying? And I commenced drinking vodka right after that. You know, I was like, I don't think so. So it was bad. You know, it was really bad. And then, like, right after that, I've got my wife and everything shifted.
My name is Cheryl Avery. I've been knowing Sam for 20 years. The difference in him that I've noticed between meeting him and knowing him now is he's more domesticated. He's, as far as his music though, it's he's grown by leaps and bounds. I call him a genius, but I'm his wife, so. But as far as personally, in his personal life, he's calmed down and he's focused. He's always focused. You know, I'll fight anybody over him. I will fight anybody over him. He's not just a beat maker. He's not just a musician. He knows his stuff and he knows, it's almost like sometimes he can plug into your mind and hear exactly what you hear in your spirit or in your soul when you're creating your own song.
Tetris introduces me to his old manager, DJ Luster. And DJ's like, I got this artist I want you to work with. In California, he wrote for Tupac. His name is MC Nice. And I'm like, oh, okay. So me and Nice talk on the phone, and he's just real energetic. Just, yo, what's up, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, hey, what's up, man? You know what I'm saying? Yo, I love your work, man. You got that down south. I got this record I'm working on called King Kong. And I'm like, all right, you know. I would do records for him, and he'd shoot me something back, and I wouldn't hear him for 6 months, man. I shoot him a record with him back in 6 months. Now, he's a year. 6 months equals years after a while. And so finally, after one point, he goes, I need this record. I had this record where I had sampled Lil Wayne. And I had him sampling him going, I go stupid, I go dumber, I go stupid, you know. It's kind of one of those beats. And he went crazy over that beat. He was like, I gotta get that beat. And I'm like, okay. You know, and I didn't hear nothing for some months. That's how me and Nice always work. Don't hear nothing. He's just getting in, don't hear nothing. And like 3 or 4 months later, he was like, yeah, I did the record in French. I was like, what? And he was like, the record's been redone in French. It's called Tout le monde en flic. And I was like, oh, word? And he was like, yeah, it's probably gonna be on the Grammy ballot. And I was like, huh? You know what I'm saying? Like, for real? And he's like, yeah. And I look up, and I get a notification, and I get, you know, a picture on Facebook, on my phone. It's a Grammy ballot. And my name's on the freaking Grammy ballot. And I'm like, oh my God, is this real? You know? The next summer, Nice comes to me and says, you know, I'm going back to my roots. And I'm like, oh, okay. You know, he's like, I'm gonna do a whole album, I'm gonna do a gospel album. So I sent him like a pack of beats. I sent like 15 beats. He chose 14. And that would become praise. That would become the album that went number one. Like, all those beats. It was one record that I didn't send him in that pack. And that was Angels. That was the one, the big one. I didn't send him that one. That was a beat I had made for my daughter. And I was going to keep that to myself. And I was like, nobody ever get this. And in that, after we had the pack, and he was like, well, the album's about done. I just need one more joint, man. He's like, I'm just looking for that joint. I need that joint something. I did not want to get off of that beat, man. I was like, well, I let him hear it. And he went nuts. And he was like, well, we ain't got but one problem. And I was like, what's that? He's like, I didn't even play the sample, man. I'm an underground producer. I don't play a sample. So I was like, I don't know how to clear no sample. And he was like, well, I'll take care of that, you know. And so he hit me the next day and was like, yeah, we're good on the sample. I spoke with Mr. Smallwood. I was like, excuse me? He was like, yeah, Mr. Smallwood, I called him. I was like, you call Richard Smallwood? He was like, yeah. So first off, how'd you get his number? He was like, did my homework, did some research. I got his number, I called him. He was happy to speak to me. And he said he was very honored that we was using his record. And I was like, are you serious? I'm on the phone bawling. I'm like, are you serious? And he's like, yeah. And, you know, so he's behind us. He's supporting this record. And it's like, everything I was trying to do, I realized that I was trying to do on one side that wouldn't work, became easy on the other side. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, all of it, all the purpose got revealed in the one deal. You know what I'm saying? My first deal was in 2008, Ways Entertainment, right? That's 8-Ball Entertainment. That was my first real record deal. This was 2018. So you're talking about 18 years. But I was trying to do it one way. And that summer, the summer of 2018, when he comes to me and says, I'm going to do this, and I'm like, all right, here goes some beats. You know what I'm saying? And he comes back. That summer, everything changed. In one summer. So it took 18 years for me doing it one way and me finally submitting and being like, all right, cool. I'm going to do it this way. And it worked.
Fear shouldn't be in your vocabulary. So that's it, man. That's how I went from nothing and doing it to having to do. I gotta be honest. I don't do half as much work now, but everything I do manifests that much more fruit. That's your boy in a nutshell.